on the 12th of November, then we open this meeting with, I don't know what the, don't we usually pray? Yes or no? Okay, let's open this meeting for November 12th personal board meeting. I'm Carl Blair, and I'm chairing, sitting in for Teresa. First, let's go over the agenda for a personal board meeting, approval of minutes for October 8th.
Motion to approve.
I second.
It has been motion and second, the meetings for October 8th.
I have, are we in a discussion?
You approved the meetings from October 8th, correct? I mean, you were.
No, I made a motion, then you have a second, and then discussion.
Okay.
You can't discuss until you motion, right?
Until it's been accepted afterwards, okay?
Well, I'm going to vote no. I have changes, so like at city council, you have a motion to approve, a second to approve. Is there any discussion? And then they vote.
Okay.
That's at least the Robert's rules that I go by then.
Okay.
So if we're in discussion, I have a couple of items.
We could have opened this discussion for the meeting minutes for our last meeting, October 8th.
Okay. On, under staff liaison, Brian Kidney was also here as well, if I remember correctly. We can add that to the minutes. Under the first, or excuse me, the second motion, it says, motion made to hold regularly scheduled board meetings on, can we add the second Friday of every month to that? And that's all I have. There's notes.
Okay. Anything, any other further discussion about our meeting minutes from October 8th? Okay, it's been accepted, in motion to accept.
You want to go ahead?
Second.
I think what we should do is, since there has been some amendments suggested, what we should do is have a motion to approve as amended. Or to, yeah, to accept those changes. Is everyone good with those changes?
So I will amend my, I will make a motion that we accept the minutes of the October 8th, 2021 personnel board meeting.
Amended.
Minutes as amended.
A second.
It's been motion and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. All right. Today's agenda is the discussion and recommendations which addresses adding a policy on leave time for victim of domestic violence. House Bill 432. All right, do we have that in front of us here?
Yes.
Okay. Any discussion about this?
Chair.
Yes.
On page two, under subsection seven there, the very last paragraph, I would amend it to say, or the production of explicit, so like third lines from the bottom, sexual material as defined in section 573.010 of the Missouri Revised Statute, because it does not, there's not referenced anywhere else that that is part of the Missouri Revised Statute. I don't want someone looking around in other policies of ours looking for a 573, because thankfully there aren't that many. Page four, section H, this is very much of a Scribner type thing. Every other G, F, E, and everything is the first word and then a dash instead of a colon. Very, very, very minor. Not non-issue. Not a big issue at all. But, and then my final question to council would be, does this mirror the state language to the T?
So this does mirror the state language. So as you're aware, Missouri is one of, probably the last states to actually put in place leave time for people that are victims of sexual violence or domestic violence. There are a couple changes, though, that we did make. It pretty much mirrors the state statute. There's a couple things, though, that we changed that would work better for the city. And one of those being that there is a notice requirement. So when an employee is requesting to take this leave, they're required to give, under the statute, their supervisor notice. It's a 48-hour notice, if they can. And so one of the things that we want to make sure, or one of the things that I know Jennifer wanted to make sure is that from her perspective, from the HR department, should know this as well. Further, that all the certification documents that the employee would have to provide the city, that that goes directly to her. And so that, that way she can keep that information and keep it as confidential as possible, rather than supplying that to the supervisor, which is where the statute basically kind of lays out. So those were the, really those couple changes are really the bulk of what we changed.
So we leave in there the process to take leave, that they need to contact their supervisor, which again is, you at least need to call in, so you're not coming in, assuming
yes.
it's not, assuming it's practical.
Yeah, right,
and
right.
then HR, and then from there, all of the official documentation from there goes straight to HR.
Exactly.
I think that's a great change.
So. Did you want me to explain a little bit about, I don't know if anybody's, you know, if everyone's read it, or did you want me to go through and explain any of it, or?
A brief summary would enlighten all of us.
Okay, all right. So in essence, what this is it's a leave, and it's really based on the number of employees that a city has. So very small cities, if you have 19 or fewer employees, they're not required to provide this type of leave. But then once you get to 20 to 49, they're entitled to one work week of leave time. And then anything 50 and above, as far as employees, are entitled to 2 weeks of unpaid leave per 12-month period. This is similar to FMLA, that is unpaid leave, that their benefits continue while they're on this leave. They are guaranteed their position when they come back. They can take the leave intermittently, and there's a list of criteria of why they can take the leave. There's actually 5 different reasons, which is kind of listed on page 1, but it's such things as you're seeking medical attention, either for yourself or someone in your family or household that is suffering from or is a victim of domestic violence. You're, you know, trying to obtain some kind of psychological or counseling of some kind. Maybe you're having to move temporarily, or you're seeking some kind of legal assistance. And again, this kind of leave can be taken intermittently, but it does not extend what the FMLA gives you, 12 weeks of unpaid leave. It doesn't extend that 12 weeks, another couple weeks, so if that makes sense. Again, what this policy requires is that if an employee needs to take this time off, that they again give notice, preferably at least 48 hours of notice, to their supervisor and the HR department. You know, obviously if they can't do that, we understand, but they need to then follow up as soon as possible. And we have in here within 48 hours that I had to take this leave, or I'm taking this leave because of this qualifying event. They are required to provide certification to the city. And part of that certification is a sworn statement that this is why I need to take the leave, as well as some kind of documentation to then support that leave. Because one of the things we have in here is if it's determined later on that they weren't, you know, they were taking the leave, but they didn't need to take the leave, That is grounds for termination. The other thing that this requires is reasonable accommodations. So for example, if you have an employee that is subject to, you know, some kind of domestic violence, and they come to the city and say, okay, I need to, you know, change my phone number, I need to change where I'm sitting because this person knows where I'm at, whatever type of reasonable accommodations the city will look at. Obviously, if it causes some kind of undue hardship on the city, meaning we really can't provide you that type of accommodation, it doesn't require the city to provide something that the city couldn't otherwise provide, that would be, you know, some kind of undue hardship. So
could you back
up to what you said about if it's later determined that they didn't need it, that it was grounds for termination. I don't remember reading that. What section is it?
It's under fraud. It's page four.
Oh, where I actually talked about the.
Yes, where we needed to, yeah.
So up to and including discharge, not automatic.
Not automatic, right.
And so, who is the judge of whether something is false or misleading? Now, I can see maybe some obvious situations maybe, but if someone feels like they are a victim, who in the city is going to say, okay, I don't believe that was, that qualified for this? Who's going to make that decision, and what is that? What are those prior, or what would be the items considered for?
Sure. Good question. And so the way I see this working, it's not that I don't think the city is going to say, okay, you provided us a note from an attorney, and this attorney practices bankruptcy and doesn't practice domestic violence, so we're not going to believe you. That's not the situation that I think. What I think is if someone says, I need to take this leave, because I have to go get some, go counseling, or I have to do certain things. And then you see on Facebook, they posted, oh, well, I'm down at the lake and I'm, having a great time. And I think that's where I see that something like this would come to play. And Brian, maybe you can help me out with this, what the city's normal process would be. But typically we probably turn it into a supervisor or even the HR department, or how would that work?
Yeah, so we would start an investigation, any kind of investigation if someone made that claim.
Okay.
So for instance, if the supervisor then made the claim that said, hey, we saw this on Facebook or whatever, we have reason not to believe it. Then we have a confidential investigation, either done by staff, or if it's a little bit more technical, we would outsource it to somebody to make sure that there's, we have the right type of investigation, that we don't have someone investigating who's not, who doesn't understand this issue. So it might be a case where we get a specialist kind of person, like understanding it, but we would go through a full investigation.
Similar as you would to any FMLA situation.
That's exactly.
So you've done FMLA for years. So this is just another group.
Yeah, FMLA is a little bit, you have the doctor's signature and stuff on that, but and then on top, after everything goes through, of course, then there's the appeals process that we have that would ultimately come to this board for determination if it was questioned.
Is this applicable? Is this applicable for part-time people as well as full-time people?
It is. It is applicable, but their work week is going to be defined a little differently, I think, depending on what their typical work week is. So if they're used to working 20 hours a week, that's their work week versus a full-time employee's work week, which will be a little bit different.
So you couldn't tell the part-time employee that, hey, you only work 20 hours, so you got a lot of time to seek counseling outside of the minimal 20 hours that you're working. You couldn't do that?
We couldn't do that. I mean, I guess we could ask, but again, this leave is provided for employees, and employees defined very broadly under the statute. As anyone who really works and gets, actually, let me pull up that statute here. Employees is any person performing work or service of any kind or character for hire. So this would not be volunteers. So a lot of times parks departments will have a lot of volunteers. So this type of leave would not, that they would not be eligible for, but I take that to mean that includes part-time.
Mm-hmm. So, what about somebody that's scheduled 12 hours on, or 24, like a fire department, so they can get it taken care of in 3 or 4 hours, then are they expected to return into their shift?
So
they get the entire shift off.
Right. And I think that's up to them. If they want to take it intermittently, which they can take this type of leave intermittently. It's just more of a documentation process at that time, and making sure we're documenting.
But the city has no right to expect that they return to work. So in other words, if I'm working 8 hours, and I needed to go to a doctor's appointment from 9 to 10, I don't get the entire day off. I mean, I gotta come back to work. I guess Brian would have to come back to work, you know, if he wants to go to the dentist or, you know, or some other kind of practitioner. So what do you do in a case like that? I mean, what do you do when you have to staff, say, bring another firefighter in, you know, to work that shift?
Then you do.
Or do you, you know, and then you're gonna pay that firefighter overtime.
Right.
At premium hours. And so in a case like that, seems like that's kind of, I mean, the firefighter has 48 off. So why can't he or she take care of that business during off-duty time?
I don't believe, and Jennifer will obviously, will tell me if I'm right or wrong, but we have to offer this as a minimum. And we can't say, well, you know, you have 3 days off, so you need to go deal with it then. Because that would be discriminating against someone getting this and someone not getting this. So if they say, here is, I think, more to the question, and this is what the concern I raised last time is with a 24-hour shift person, this is in terms of work week. Well, now we're talking about hours. So like if you're part-time and you work Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and you're part-time, that person's work week is Monday, Wednesday, Friday. It's not 20 hours a week, right? Because then you look at firefighters, and let me throw this, the short side of that is, a firefighter works 52.1 or 52.3, whatever their average work week is, but their work week is, so, you know, let's say it's 52 hours. So now they have 52 hours is considered their work week for time to take off for this?
Well, you don't have to take in a full week, though. You don't.
No, I understand what you're saying. But and to your point, like say I work, you know, I'm out here at the desk. I work out here taking payments or whatever. I work 8 to 5 taking payments. I tell my supervisor I need to go to an appointment or to an attorney's appointment. And they're like, okay, we understand, and you're going to record this under your whatever the acronym will end up being for this. And that person says, yes, I'll be back in 2 hours. And they say, okay, that will be fine. Or they say, I need to take the day off because I need to do this. And you say, okay, that's fine. You know, I think that depends on the situation. If the super, like in a fire department, the battalion chief, assistant chief, whoever's chief would have to make the decision. You know, you're telling us what you need. And typically, and yes, you're going to have to staff because the fire department has a minimum staffing rule. And if you have somebody out, regardless of if it's FMLA, this, sick, whatever it is, vacation, you have minimum staffing requirements that they have to bring in people to do that. So we have that already for FMLA, for COVID, for all those other things. So that is definitely going to happen if this comes into play.
Well, I understand it overlays the difficulties of trying to staff the department. If you've got a fire truck at number 2 needing to respond to a call, and you only have 2 firefighters available to run that pumper truck, what are you going to do? Run it to 2, or are you going to say, well, we need that from number 7
no,
to come all the way out? And therefore, you're really screwing the citizens, put it bluntly, because you've had a lot longer response time from station 7 than you would 2. And, you know, I think
they're going to staff that.
What's that?
They're going to staff that. I mean,
they may staff it, but still, that doesn't, the extra 3 or 4 or 5 minutes to get to Country Meadows, for example, or Carrington, you tell that to the person that's had a heart attack or the house is on fire. And, you know, I think maybe somewhere we need to think about the citizens who pay the taxes, you know, that like we do expect a fire truck in a timely manner within the limits of. What is it, 8 minutes or response on it?
Well, but so, if you think about it, so if let's just say on a day like today when Jennifer had to leave all of a sudden, if there's a firefighter who's gotten sick or has a family emergency and needs to leave, they leave. Well, in the meantime, the battalion chief is calling somebody who's on the list for either required overtime or requested overtime. You need to come in to station two. In the meantime, there's still one other firefighter there, or two, depending on if they have two or three staffing or whatever. So they may be down a person, but the battalion chief is going to know, I have made a call to Jim Smith, who's on his way to twos. Okay, now twos catches a cardiac arrest call. Okay. Dispatch knows they're down a person, the battalion chief knows they're down a person, and you're going on a cardiac arrest. You need multiple people on a cardiac arrest, and one or two person crew is going to be tough for that. So they're going to dispatch another truck. But twos is still going to get there in less than 8 minutes to get started on CPR or whatever it is. AMR's on the way, presumably, and the battalion chief's going to head that direction, and they'll probably send another truck because they know that that's down. And that happens regardless of whether somebody has to call off for this policy or because they went into the bathroom and they got sick and can't work, you know what I mean? I don't think
this... But this should be, this is a planned off time.
No, yeah, I mean, yeah, but if
that's
I...
I'm listening. This is a plan. It's, no. Let's take Jennifer as an example.
Okay.
That was an unexpected emergency, and yes, she had to leave. So it wasn't planned. When there's and we're speaking specifically about trauma, we're speaking specifically about sexual, victim of domestic violence. Right. We're speaking specifically about that, okay?
Right.
When that occurs, okay, Jennifer is, like I said, she's a very good example of an emergency. And guess what? The fire department's been dealing with that for years, because yeah, they do, it's life, okay? But in this case, when you're talking about domestic violence and sexual assault, this is, I can't say it's in a different realm. This is not, let's say if your grandchild or any one of us have or is affected by that, okay? The after effects is what this is addressing, meaning this person is going to have some counseling, this person has a court, this person has... This is what this is going to accomplish. Now, the emergency of it, the actual event happening right then and there, that's already in our policy or in the HR's policy for emergencies, just like Jennifer, she left, okay? But this is a policy. I don't want to use the term after the effect, but this is a policy set in place for people of a victim of these of this crime. But it's not an emergency. Not. Hey, yeah, listen, I got, you know, my kid got in trouble, blah, blah, blah. I got to go. Okay, we can work, deal with that. But after that, okay, my kid has court. My child has a doctor's appointment. That's pre-set up or pre-appointed, meaning you're going to tell you the, you're going to give it to the HR department or your supervisor, and it's going to follow the chain of command, and the chain of command will say, oh, okay, well, okay. The third, if you work 20 hours, guess what? And you need Wednesday. Hey, you plan that. It's already at. It's not a pop up.
But it could be. What if I get a what if I have a domestic? You know, I'm not married, but my spouse and I get into a domestic. Something can happen in the middle of the night, and this would apply. I mean, okay. Okay, so I now am a victim. Let's say I needed to go to the hospital because I've had injuries. I need to file a police report and all those things. My shift starts at 8 in the morning.
Understandable.
Right, that's an emergency.
Correct.
You know, I can't plan when I'm going to have a domestic violence situation.
The follow-up, of course.
Well, the follow-up, yes.
The follow-up. We're speaking about the weeks after or the day after or the whatever. This is in place to... allow those victims to take care of those situations. Okay, we already have an emergency plan that, hey, what it doesn't matter whether it's physical or domestic violence. If you need that day, you call and say, hey, I can't make it, I'm not gonna make it because whatever, okay? And that's acceptable. The fire department, police department, all the, our employees are in that's set up already. Am I saying it correctly? That, hey, you could call in on any job, okay? But after you call in, if you need more days, We all work jobs. If you need another day or the next day, that's what this is in place for.
Okay, I was under the impression this could be for that emergency thing, the very first occurrence, all the way through, whatever. So I see it as something that could be a call-off, that the VC finds out about at, you know, 7:30 in the morning, calls in for another staff.
And then after that, what do? You report it to your supervisor, say, hey, I'm gonna need next Wednesday, y'all. I'm gonna need tomorrow.
Right, but I'm talking about that initial event.
That initial event is already in place.
Right.
Because for, in our HR department, HR policy.
So.
All emergencies.
So I still want to understand this piece of, when I read this as work week, I talked to the deputy chief of the fire department, and I said, is that makes sense for you? Because they're 24-hour shifts. Everything is different in a 24-hour shift world. So what is their work week? They don't work Monday through Friday, 8 to 5 every day. They might work Sunday, Tuesday, you know, Sunday, Wednesday, Thursday, you know, it's different. So are you talking, and then you said that the comment about, well, if you're an employee who only works 20 hours a week, then you have 20 hours of this time times 2 weeks. I don't understand the calculation of that.
So the way it's defined both in the statute and what this, and then this policy is the work week is the individual employee's standard work week. So it would be different for a different employee. It could be, you know, different. So, yes.
Okay, so a person who works Monday, Wednesday, Friday. Mm-hmm. Obviously on their day off, it doesn't matter what they do, because that's not, right, that's not time. So they would have, and Wednesday, Friday. Mm-hmm. Okay, so if a firefighter works a Sunday, Wednesday, they don't all work, like your shift isn't Monday, Wednesday, Friday, your Tuesday, Thursday, yeah, Saturday, you know. So is it just determined Tuesday? All of the
thing is their work week is defined however their work week. So if
51.3 hours,
that's how we're defined
schedule. If they're scheduled different this week and next week, okay, and they need, mm-hmm, and because this like a okay, they really are. They're going, firefighter going to say, hey.
But they don't ask the first time.
No, that's already covered. For an emergency, you already get that off.
I know, but when do you start and have?
Hey, my point is, this is asked for. They're going to, that's just like FMLA. They ask for FMLA. I've never been on
a. 20 hours of FMLA constitutes a week.
Ask for FML.
So they'll get 102.2.
Whatever their week schedule is, I think, whatever, whether it's 20 hours, 32 hours is part-time, 51 hours, whatever their hourly week is, that's what they are entitled to. I'm pretty sure she's been conveying that.
Okay, I'll let it be then. I just want to make sure that it has been covered so that we don't have a situation, sure, where it's undetermined and when it starts and how it's accounted for.
Right.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Well, okay, it may be in here, and sure, I did read it and everything, okay, but when a person starts, in other words, if they start 2 weeks ago, Are they automatically entitled to this, or is there a waiting period? It's been a while since I've dealt with family medical leave. I thought there might be a waiting period for that.
You were right. On family medical leave, there is a waiting period.
And so they can do this right out of the chute, basically.
They could.
And I'm just trying to think sometimes why would they not want to take family medical leave, particularly if they've got to build up a sick leave and time, a PTO, whatever it's called. Why would they want to take family leave so they can actually get paid rather than have unpaid?
Well, under this program, they can elect.
Right, but FMLA is not a compensation.
Right.
It is a amount of time being held, basically, that your job is held.
Well, yeah, but I mean, if a person's been there any length of time and they build up any PTO or sick leave, they can draw on that.
That's exactly it.
Fill in the gaps, yeah.
Yeah, that's exactly it. And the same is in the policy before you is that if they choose, if they want to use any type of sick time or vacation time, you know, that they can use that time.
But they don't have to. They can go unpaid if they choose.
Or if they run out of PTO.
Yeah, like you started 2 weeks ago and you don't have any PTO and you don't have any whatever, and then you have an event, you're going to be unpaid. But your job is still held, your position is held. We can't fill that. We can't demote you. We can't take away your insurance.
Right.
Sure, under this policy, what is the total length of time? Well, you all know people that have had issues like this that have lasted for years. Is there a cutoff point that, hey, look, after you've been gone for X number of hours, you know, it sort of ceases. We just can't put up with this that much. We want to accommodate your needs, but we've still got a department.
Yeah, absolutely. So the maximum is 2 weeks. It's the maximum under this policy is 2 weeks of unpaid leave.
Okay, and then when does it start again? I mean, is it a one-time shot and forever?
No, it's every 12-month period.
So they can use up to 80 hours of pay, 80 hours.
A standard, let's just say, yeah, exactly. We'll just, yeah.
And they can do that every two.
Every year.
Every year.
One time a year, yeah, once a year. But again, that does not extend. So if they also had an event where they had to take FMLA leave, they had a medical condition and they had to take FMLA leave, they couldn't take between FMLA and this domestic leave violence policy, they couldn't take more than 12 weeks total in one-year period.
Well, you get to the point, and it sounds heartless, I'm sure, to some people, that maybe this person probably should not be working. Maybe they should tend to their personal problems initially and then come back into the employment market because
How are you going to tell somebody that?
Well, I'm just saying, in discussion, I mean, isn't there a point that, you know, we got to respond to the fire, we got to respond to the police call, or we got to pay the streets, or you know, somebody running snowplow, if we get 11 inches of snow, it's like, well, he's on or she's on some type of leave, so we can't get to your streets. You know, they're going to have to be ice covered.
Well, and I think that any department, like for instance, the fire department's going to be, it's not going to be a problem because they have a minimum staffing requirement for their union contract that has to be followed. Police do not have a minimum staffing requirement. So if you're supposed to be, I'm making up something, six cars working traffic today and four of them are sick and they don't have anybody to backfill, they don't have to bring in on overtime. So they'll just run two cars of traffic.
It's like I see the highway patrol stopping people on Lee Summit Road. It's like, what is this all about? You know, I don't know.
Well, I don't know anything about that.
They just don't have enough police officers. Or what the deal is.
I don't know anything about that piece of what they do. But, but I mean, each department has, if they, like I said, the fire department has a minimum staffing requirement. Mm-hmm. They will and they have to do that. And they have done that. Snowplows, I don't know what Community Works has as a requirement.
So just to answer the question, all departments do have like an excessive leave. Like, okay, you've been taking way too much time, we can't get your job done. I've had that, and we have that unfortunately frequently from time to time. what this policy does is protect that employee.
Right.
From us making a determination that they're using excess leave that's protected. And so we, you know, unfortunately, we've had people who do abuse policies from time to time, but there's a process for that. And that's what this is doing, is just make sure that that's being followed.
Because it is, it's a, FMLA is a federally protected, and this is a state protected right. Then if you do get to the point where they've run out of either this and or FMLA, then that's when you can say, you can't hold your job any longer, if that's what you decide to do. You don't have to do
that.
Yeah,
there's a level.
But then you can say, okay, yeah, you've, just like any other company, you have now, you know, run out of your 12 weeks. And we don't have to take, you know, we can now restaff your job if we want to, or whatever. Some choose to not do that. They give them extended time. But right, we have to have the federally protected with the state protected piece in there.
And you both bring up a good point that I'd like to maybe make a suggestion on adding into this policy, just to make it clear that the amount an eligible employee may take of this unpaid leave is 2 work weeks in a 12-month period. I left off that in a 12-month period, but just to make it clear, this is not, you know, either 2 weeks or
you can't do 2 weeks and then 6 months later.
Yeah.
Now we need another two. Now, also, too, when does that year start?
So
is it the city's fiscal year?
So, yeah, this is interesting. So it just, so some cities do FMLA a little bit differently, where they do it on a rolling calendar.
Uh-huh.
So it's a look back period. So someone needs to take the leave. You look back the last 12 months. Have you taken any FMLA leave or this leave? And if so, then we have to knock back
right
the amount you've taken. And that's, you know, so I don't know what the city does. I'll be honest with you. I'd have to get it. Or if you do it on a calendar year.
I believe we do a look back.
Oh, you do a look back. Okay.
Okay. So basically it's kind of what is happening with this particular incident you're having right now is when you're then, if you look back and you say, nope, you haven't done anything, so your year starts now to a year from now. Yeah, that
right.
That makes sense.
Right.
As opposed to you started in January.
Yes.
And it starts over again in January. Which you cannot watch every employee. I can't even imagine the nightmare trying to, you know, it's not by your hire year, it's
yes.
not by the city's fiscal year, it's not a calendar year.
Oh, right. Yeah.
It's per incident.
Right.
With a look back. That makes sense. Okay.
Right.
Would it at all make any sense when you're doing some revisions, maybe to say an employee who has passed their probationary period would be covered, or is that contrary to what was passed by?
I don't think the state allows.
I was going to say, I think we may at that point be prohibiting what the state is allowing, because the state is allowing.
That's what I'm asking.
Yeah.
It's like, would that be contrary to the intent or the
exactly.
wording of the state law?
Right, right.
And what might be interesting too is that there's this time the employee is not defined in the definition section.
And we can certainly define employee. We can certainly define, yeah.
Because it's not defined there.
Okay.
And then, excuse me, I don't know at the top of our personnel policies and procedures that I don't have printed out. You know, we have different kinds of employees. So,
yeah.
You know, maybe it references employees as defined by section 1.1 through 5 or
right,
whatever it is.
Yeah, yeah. And the statute defines, and we can certainly
yeah
take that and define it. So, yeah, absolutely.
Then that'll eliminate the question mm-hmm. of.
I do have one question.
Okay.
It's about your 48 hours unscheduled absence.
Oh, okay.
What if the employee is not able to give a statement or be able to call you, their HR department, let them know? Is a family member acceptable or something like that? I'm only asking because I worked with somebody that years ago that was actually a victim of domestic violence and was left for dead. And was in a coma for 8 months. And so she was not able to do that. Her family members had to notify the HR department.
I think the city would definitely work with, you know, the family or, you know, obviously the idea here is that, yes, we want notice, but if notice can't be given, then we'd like, you know, someone to follow up with the city as soon as possible with that information. So I definitely think the city would work with the employee.
And I think, and I agree, I think that's said here, you know, the city will not take action against employee if they provide that. Like, okay, you've been AWOL for 48 hours and now someone reaches out to us and it's like, oh, you're, okay, that's fine. Then you provided the certification. We're not going to.
Domestic violence assault.
So will the board then consider a motion to move this to council?
Subject to those revisions and that we kind of talked about.
Can we get a motion?
Yeah, I'll move that we submit this and with these amendments that we've
discussed.
Second.
It is motion is second. Any further discussion? Okay, the next thing on, I'm sorry.
All those in favor?
All those in favor.
All those in favor, yeah.
Aye.
Those opposed?
All right, there.
All right.
Now, are we going to, you know, Trish had sent out something about sort of a timetable on one of her emails and it was like, you know, it was like over a year, I think. I mean, what is it? I never quite understood that when she sent that out, like, we're going to take up this and then go. So can you explain that maybe?
So.
What our future, in other words, if this goes to the council, are we still going to be working on more?
Yes.
And the question is, why and.
Sure.
You know, maybe
sure, yeah, absolutely, absolutely. So just for this particular one, just so everyone's aware, your recommendation is going to be for, once I've made the revisions, your recommendation is going to be forwarded to the city council. And I believe we're going to try and get that on the November 22nd. I don't know if we can get that on the 22nd or not.
Yes, I think our calendar had that.
Oh, did we mix them reviewed? Okay.
City council reviews personal board recommendations regarding proposed changes at a work session. Do we have where we take it to a work session? I
don't know why we take it to a work session.
I wouldn't think so either after this.
Unless they request it.
So that was just more or less something that I had stuck in there thinking that they may want to have a discussion about it before it comes for final determination.
But they would be able to do that at the meeting, I guess.
Okay.
Yeah.
So if that's the case, then.
So I'll put it on for a resolution. So this resolution.
Yes, I did. I have it as a resolution.
So I'll put this on as a resolution on the 22nd, the meeting of the 22nd.
22nd.
Monday a study session? Monday's a regular session.
Oh, shoot. I'm sorry. I'll put it on for the December 6th.
I was going to say, because we got study session coming up, then we have a fifth Monday in there.
We got a fifth Monday, so it'd be December 6th.
So this one will go, yes, December 6th to the city council for review and possible action.
And then we'll say, you know, they'll say that Brian will say that this came with a recommendation of the personnel board. Then if they want to kick it to a study session to talk about it next week. Otherwise, I think they're going to read it in.
Okay. I see what it is. So it was originally thought of that it would go to the. Recommendation here is to take directly to the council meeting on December 6th, and then that's what we'll do.
Okay.
I think that's good. This is a simple state law required change. It already went into effect on August 28th. We need to get it on the books.
Yeah.
I don't see them wanting to delve into this.
Right.
But what you're talking about is the next item on the agenda.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes. So my understanding and where I think you were going with this is I think I provided kind of an outline. One of the things that city had asked me about was you know, a lot of the policies that are in place just haven't been looked at in years. And so I think staff just wanted to, well, there's a couple of things, plus there's been some administrative policies put in place that possibly should probably really go into the personnel policy. And there's just some cleaning up stuff that probably that we need to do and address. And so I was suggesting a one way to accomplish this. There, I think there's several ways we could do this, but I was suggesting one way to accomplish it, which was kind of that long, long outline that I provided, which was, you know, taking it chapter by chapter in essence is what I was looking at. But one of the things that we discussed at the last meeting was, is there a like priorities list, you know, rather than taking chapter one and then move to chapter two, maybe there's more priorities out there. And I was working with Jennifer on that. And so we did come up with a revised schedule. She makes some copies here, so let me.
And I'd like to make a statement once you hand that out.
Yeah, absolutely.
Get into this.
Thank you.
Okay.
This is only a draft. Let me just say, first of all, this is only a draft. It's working. It's going to be always evolving. So I didn't even really put dates on it because.
But this doesn't include nearly all the policies we're talking about reviewing.
Well, again, it was only priorities. It was not.
We did that 2 years ago.
What's that?
The 80-20 split, because it was a big discussion or a big thing about either it was 2 or 3 years ago. You were here, Ron.
We talked about it.
They were picking it out in front of where he was one of the speakers. He was picking it about it because it was been taken and the city couldn't afford to continue to 100%. So it went.
That was a meeting we had at the police department.
Yeah,
right. I didn't know what the final determination was.
Yeah.
Well, basically, but right now
the council picked that up and they did their own. I don't know. I'm lost for words, but they did it and they sent it to us and we approved it about 3 years ago.
Well,
when it came
that,
to the,
and
I'm
it's
only speaking about the insurance part. Okay.
It's changed since then.
Yeah, it's changed.
It has changed. The Medicare eligible and retirees are different. Between retirement and 64 is different.
Yeah,
here is different. But fire department has 80-20. I think every other department is 70-30, or at one point they talked about 83-26 or some whatever. It's like
I probably should have used the health insurance instead of I mean, you could apply that to any benefit. You can say, well, if I'm going to work 2 days a week at the city, maybe I don't need vacation time.
We wouldn't give you. That's defined by your part time. You don't get vacation time. We have. I mean, we don't. Yeah. I mean, tell me if I'm wrong. We don't have any part time employees who have access to health insurance, sick time, loggers.
That was also taken care of in that
revised
recommendation.
Yeah.
Years ago, because it went.
Like, there's a cutoff point.
There's a
regular part time.
32 hours under 32 hours. I don't.
That's the ACA.
You can pay for. I think that the our policy that we passed agreed upon. I think 30. They gonna pay for it. They said we'll offer it, but you gotta pay for it yourself. He was here too. I remember when he was going through all that insurance policy. A few years ago, and he was in front of the police the courthouse, and they were trying to cut, because we used to be, ex-employees used to have 100%, and they changed it from 100 to...
You're talking about retirees.
Yeah, retirees, I'm sorry. They
not
changed
employees.
It to 60% or 80%, they was going back and forth. Cause it was, that was addressed back then.
But if you look at the personnel policies and procedures, it defines what, you know, like a part-time employee and exempt and a...
Yeah. I know every place I've ever worked, it's always a 20-hour. Truman Medical Center was 20 hours. I think you would earn benefits on a prorated basis if you worked 20 hours or more. And other places are like 24, which would be like 3 8-hour shifts. Then you could get a proportional benefit. So now a lot of places do
I think
that.
We follow the ACA, which is...
Yeah.
Because we...
Yourself.
I'm just trying to find money to compensate the employee or these, $15 an hour.
Yeah.
You know, and I hear them talking about they're short of money and.
And that's why I think we should just ask for the update from, that we requested last month from Zach Walker related to cost.
You what? Repeat that?
We asked in the last meeting or the meeting before, I don't remember which, that we asked that be taken to, I made a motion that be taken to Zach Walker and that he provides us a report in time to be considered for the next budget season. So I think we just need to ask it on our next agenda. An agenda item needs to be update from city manager or Adam or, you know, whoever, from the city manager's office about where they are in the cost benefit analysis of $15. And I say cost benefit analysis, is probably just a better word. So to figuring out how many employees we're talking about, so how much money is that? You know, what does that take? What does that, you know, does that cause compression? I'm always concerned about compensation compression. When you start just raising the bottom up, you're going to have compression. So we want to know about that. So I think on our agenda, we should just ask for a follow-up on where he's at with that. We could sit and talk about it all day, but I don't think we're going to have any idea how much money we're talking about.
Exactly. We got to know that.
So we just need to get, it's the city manager's office to, or whoever he appoints to get back to.
And the last thing I have, and I just, you know, for future meetings, do we have an employee assistant that in existence here?
Yes.
In other words, if an employee has a.
Yes.
I mean, it's applied across the board to all employees, maybe not just, you know, in this contract or.
We have EAP here.
To everybody.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah, we have EAP and also we're working on a specialized EAP for public safety first responders too.
Okay. Well, we're just brainstorming, so I.
No, I was just saying, we already.
I want to be informed a little bit, so, you know.
Yeah, I mean, and that's in the policies and procedures that they have on.
Okay.
So.
That's all I got.
Okay. The next meeting is 10th of December. Do you have anything for the public?
Well, just, I might have got lost in the shuffle.
Yeah, you did.
I thought our policies have a point where you become part, where you become considered full-time. Don't we have that number now? X number hours makes you eligible for full-time benefits, X number doesn't.
Yeah, that would be, in the personnel policy.
We got that, okay.
Because we have to.
There was some confusion about what that number was.
Because we have to comply with it for ACA.
That's what I was thinking.
Yeah, so that's in there.
That's it. Thank you for letting me make the comment.
She bailed. Did Marla bail out?
Oh, she had something else to do. You'll see her ugly face next time.
All right. Is there anything else? Anybody? Last minute thoughts, last minute. Okay.
Adjourn.
I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Then we got a motion to adjourn.
Motion, second.
Let's take a vote.
All in favor?
All in favor?
Say bye.
Unless you want to filibuster.
I'm always abstaining. Hey, you safe with abstaining?
You're just wanting to go to the lake. That's what you want to do.
I always say abstain. That way I ain't making nobody mad.
Oh, boy. Let me tell you.
Obviously, this quarter probably doesn't subscribe to that.
There are people who are getting very upset about that. All right, good meeting, guys. Thank you.
Thank you. Do we need to turn this back in or?
No, you keep them.
You can keep that if you like, or if you don't, I can recycle it.